Hello, everybody. Welcome to the 2019 Jeep Compass. This is the limited trim I live with this car. Weeks. Sharing it with my mom. Anyway. And I should preface. Okay, I'm sorry that you're down there, but this way I can actually see the chat safely. This might take me a second of relative silence to actually figure out how to leave. Here. Oh, no, never mind. I know where I'm going. So, to preface this, I like to think that I've pretty much nixed all the brand bias. Hey, Akbar. I'm driving a Jeep! I'd like to think that I've nixed most of the brand bias out of me. I used to shit on Nissan all the time, and then I drove an Xterra and a Juke Nismo, both of which were absolutely excellent. Hey. And the Cross Cabriolet is still the worst thing on the market. The worst thing that's been on the United States auto market, at least, in the past 10 years. But, anyway, I feel like my last remaining brand bias is against Jeep. And there's a cultural... Can you hear how confused the transmission is? I don't know if you can, but it's a 9-speed ZF, and it is dumb. It really lets things down in here. And I'm really tired of getting in cars that are immediately let down by their automatics. Anyway, so of course I'm an American. I love the original Grand Cherokee. It's perfect. But growing up in a Midwestern college town with lots of suburbs and lots of suburban. Yeah, okay, I do have to say, this car, really the whole Jeep line right now, there is something interesting about it. The Compass is probably the least interesting one. It's also the worst name, but we'll get to that. So, anti-Jeep brand bias basically comes from, there's a lot of pseudo-rural people around here that live in the suburbs, but act like they farm, like they wear, you know, camo, like bootcut jeans and boots. I guess that this is sort of left over from high school, but there are a lot of kids that still do this. But they're actually kind of rich. Usually they're like upper middle class, and they might have like an acre or two of yard. But like, I grew up on a real farm, and anyway, jumping forward. So, basically, the chosen vehicles, the chosen chariots of these pseudo-rural young men are either, like, $50,000 crazy-specced 3/4-ton, so F-250 Ford trucks, which they, you know, they get leather and all that stuff, and then they blow $20,000 lifting it, and then they keep it impeccably clean and never leave. That mall crawlers term, shout out to my friend Jackson for that term. Was looking for a term for that for a long time. But the other type of mall crawler, which funny enough, now Jackson told me that he just bought a Jeep Wrangler, and I haven't seen it yet. So, but, like, the other type of mall crawler is people buy Jeep Wranglers and then manage to spend absurd amounts of money. Yeah, yeah. I mean, the Wrangler, I think, is still a real Jeep. I don't know. But, so, like, okay, and obviously there's distaste, just mostly because, at least in my case, I'm not even bothered about the, you know, not being actually rural at all, thing. But, okay, a little bit, because I think a truck should be dirty. And I think that a heated steering wheel and leather seats in a truck is an oxymoron. Because there's no reason to own a pickup truck unless you're using it, right? Hello! I'm sorry it's broken. Periscope is... One of the reasons why I've been scoping a lot is because I'm worried that Periscope's gonna go away soon. Anyway, so to wrap this up and actually get to the car, but I have actually one of the better... I am driving now. One of the better experiences I've had... Well, I drove an original Willys Jeep. It was like a 1951 or 2. And it was painted... It was restored. Painted red with white wheels. I'll be okay. Thank you, though. There's a reason that why the phone is in such a weird position, and it's because it's right at the instrument cluster. So I, you know, it's just like looking down at the speedometer. But that Willys Jeep was just a tractor. I mean, literally, I grew up driving tractors too. It was like a 4-speed manual without synchromesh. I mean, that's just a tractor, right? Metal steering wheel. And that thing was cool. I think it's funny when people, like, drive them around, like, drive a impeccably restored original Willys around in the Midwest, because that's a real thing. How old am I? I'm going to be 25 in January. I don't look it because I have a horrible haircut. I'm also, I actually do have Thanksgiving weight, shamefully enough. But, okay, I'm over, well, it's in January, but thank you. I'll remember that until then. So the compass. I just wanted to say that so you know where I'm coming from. And honestly, the whole Jeep range just has seemed overpriced for me, or to me, for a long time. And it's one of those things where, like, I can imagine so many other better alternatives. But this is my first time actually driving a modern Jeep. In fact, I think that literally the only other... I'm sorry, I still have that literally habit. The only other Jeep I've ever driven was the original. Because I don't think I've driven anything else. An acquaintance of mine had an original Grand Cherokee that... I mean, those are just cool. It's cool to have one of those. If you can find one of those for a reasonable price and that's your thing, absolutely. But anyway, the Compass is such a bad name. Jeep Compass. You think I am crush on you? Well, I hope that... Thank you, that's sweet. I hope that... that just adds to this, what would, you know, normally be a very irritating video to the normal person, and maybe I can actually help you on your next car purchase. But anyway, so this car, let's get down to the specifics. This car is a 2019 Jeep Compass Limited. It's the it's like the EX. It's the second highest trim. It's behind the Trailhawk, which I have no idea what that is. It's got a 1.8 liter, 2.4 liter inline four transversely mounted horse, making about 180 horsepower, strapped to a 9-speed ZF Freudvithaken transmission, which usually, I mean, you know, in this world now, when we hear ZF transmission, we think, wow, you know, the 8-speed, the 5-speed auto and ZF auto and then the 8-speed ZF auto came from it really have defined Jaguar for the past 30 years, 20 years, 30 years almost. Anyway, but this is awful. This is an awful pairing, and I really don't know why FCA keeps doing this. If you'll remember, I'm actually looking at getting a car now, and I was really excited about the Dodge Dart. The first episode of my car show I ever did was about the new Dodge Dart that's, you know, got Fiat components in it. And that car was great, but the transmission was so bad, the automatic, I don't know if it was a ZF or not, but the automatic was so bad, like it was the worst, pairing. Like, you really thought that something was wrong with the car. And this is kind of a widespread thing. It was like catastrophe because of that. And that could have been a really cool thing. I think it looked good, you know. So, I don't know what the fuck is up with this pairing, but okay, let's specifically what it does. Of course, it's difficult for this engine to make much torque in the low rev ranges, right? And the way that the transmission's mapped in this car, like many modern cars, is it just really forces it into high gears. And, you know, that makes sense to me, but obviously, you know, we have regulations to... we have targets to meet for efficiency. But there has to be a way. I mean, I've driven other cars in which you can do that with a small displacement engine that, you know, low torque engine, and yet still have the transmission be intelligent enough that when power is needed, it can immediately move it up the rev range, right? That's the whole purpose. That... Why else have 9 gears in a transmission? But this just doesn't. And I should never notice that, especially not regularly, and it really is. It's not just, you know, something that requires a lot of attention. It's something that you know, and it just, it doesn't lurch when you back down like that. That's good, but it just And, okay, so on this highway, I'm gonna turn on cruise control here. I actually, one thing that I did not, I forgot to get from the spec sheet was its gross weight. The gross weight of the compass, that is. But, what am I doing? I should have gone the other way home. Shucks. I would have lost signal though. and I'm not going to do a full video on this, although I would like to write about it. I'm going to try. What I was going to say is just maintaining a regular highway speed on an area that, in the grand scheme of things, does not vary topographically very much at all, requires it to downshift 2-3 times. That's called underpowered. That's what the correct adjective is there. This is actually a good example. This is a perfectly flat surface, and it's recently resurfaced. There's less noise from the tires than I thought there would be. This one has the four-wheel drive package, I should have mentioned that, I got a chance, just a really brief chance, to drive it in snow. It's a part-time four-wheel drive, but you can also manually lock it, and I didn't drive very far, but as far as I did, it didn't do the thing where it popped out eventually. I could spend my entire time with you complaining about stop-start. This is the first car I've driven in a while. I haven't been riding my cars for a long time. So, first car I've driven in a while that has stop-start, and, you know, it has a disable button, but it resets every time you turn it off. The infotainment system is excellent. CarPlay to someone like me is, you know, kind of magic, almost. The last car, my last car was a 1976 Continental Mark IV Continental. So, okay, there we go. So I'm just going through a corner. Didn't request more from the cruise control, but it literally had a downshift just because of the extra the extra resistance of turning slightly on the highway. Granted, it's not quite a jerk, but it could be smoother, and I would expect smoother from ZF. And I bet you, I'm sure it's not ZF, it's probably something about the way that it's mapped. This is just the slightest incline, and there we went down a gear. Naturally, you can move the gear selector over and select, but raise your hand if you want to do that on a transmission with 9 gears. Yeah. That's no fun. The thing I like about this is a lot of the things that I've complained about so far, like stop start and this transmission issue, it's not unique to this car. There are a lot of modern cars that end up doing this, and that's because we've put our drivetrains in a bind, basically. I probably don't need to explain the theory, it's really boring, but we keep making smaller and smaller engines, and then putting them in worse, or less and less ideal situations in terms of gear mapping, like this one. I had to go down 2 gears to get up to 3,000 RPM to get us up this incline to maintain 75 miles an hour. So the engine has 180 horsepower, right, which it's just enough, the number itself, but it doesn't have 180 horsepower at 1300 RPM. You know, that's at 6000 RPM. And I'll show you later. I'll show you in a few minutes what the engine sounds like at 6000 RPM, and it's distressing. I like the visibility. I like the ride height, surprisingly enough. These are leather seats. And if I put that, like, just the fact that Americans are so massively confused about what an American car is. Our brand identity is so fucked up, dude. Like, this is a Jeep that does have specific, like, you know, there we go, here we're going, but there, oh, that's 3 years right there. So it does have, like, the four-wheel drive thing. I'm glad they did that. It's not, you know, just a hydraulically on-demand bullshit all-wheel drive system that just adds more drag for no reason. But thinking back to what Jeep meant as a brand, what it means to a lot of people, it really means Wrangler, right? It means an unrefined, purpose-built might be taking a little far, but I mean, it came from a purpose-built military vehicle. And this has a heated steering wheel, which came on again. I know I joked about the Avalon not having a heated steering wheel, but honestly, I kind of fucking hate them. Because my hands are sweating. This has got dual zone climate control, which I could write 3,000 words about why you should never use that. Maybe not quite. The screen is too bright at night, but there's a nice handy button that says screen off. All the panning around when I stop. Have I mentioned the price yet? Jesus. I was on track. Stick to the notes. I'm actually really surprised more people aren't showing up. I mean, I wouldn't. Okay. As spec'd, it's just over $33,000. $33,094. I already told you about the transmission. I guess that's all I left out. $33,000. What else could I get for $33,000? Hello. I get a not very well equipped base 3 Series BMW. I mean, I could. What I would always say, and what I'd love to say to all those mall crawlers that I mentioned earlier, is, dude, if you have $50,000 to spend, if your parents have $50,000 to spend on your vehicle when you're 19, and you want to do something crazy, buy a Maserati, dude. If your parents have that kind of money, you have just been given the opportunity to own a Maserati Quattroporte. And not the, you know, the cool one. For whatever reason, I'm blanking on the... But it's the one. It's the one, you know, it's not the V6. It's the one with the V8 and the loud one. And that's just one example. I mean, you can get so much car for $50,000. And, like, okay, if you're going to spend... Should I just rant on it? Might as well. I'm sorry for the... They just left. it's just, I guess you could say the auto journalist in me is just in so much pain at the thought of just almost literally any other choice. Honestly, you could buy a used H1 Hummer. I have no idea what those cost at this point, but, and that would be a better choice because, you know, that's it's still a little better of a choice because it's like, I don't know. Why? Why? And like, really this perception that I have, this brand bias, isn't against Jeep as a company. Although Jeep very much knows who's still buying its products and it's very thankful. But it's just strange to me that this company still exists under the same name. I mean, it's ridiculous that the Mustang still exists under the same name. Because it, in function, target market, you know, target market is pretty similar, but not really. I mean, no, young people can't buy new cars anymore, so... what I'm trying to say is it's not anything like what the original was. It's not, it is not simple in any way. I mean, it's kind of rudimentary, but the magic of the simplicity isn't there. I mean, I drove an EcoBoost Mustang in Portland last year and it was like, it was actually kind of distracting in a almost anxiety-inducing way how much just, like, stuff I could adjust. Like the lights and the... I don't know. Hello. I was originally told, like someone mentioned, they didn't really know. They mentioned like, oh, I'm pretty sure that's a $26,000 car, as that one spec'd. That would be incredible. At that point, you know, all the other, like the road noise and even the transmission for the right person would be forgiven. It's not as bad as the Dart. It's not a ruin the automobile thing. It's still usable. Still a usable platform. But, the seats are comfortable enough. You look like Tom Brady's smart cousin. Thank you. I don't think I'm any smarter than Tom Brady. I think comparing intelligence like that, I know what you're saying, though. That's a nice compliment. My favorite thing I've ever been told on Periscope, by the way, was Disney on Ice looking ass. I mean, that's some real talent there. All right, folks. Well, I'm nearing home now. Hello, one viewer. I thought there was going to be at least a few. I've assumed that some of my car followers are probably working. How long have I been scoping? Since the very beginning, my friend. I took a pretty long hiatus, but the biggest community I've ever actually had on the internet was here on Periscope. And when I came back recently, I was treated to the experience of a bunch of people being like, whoa, we haven't seen you. We were wondering about you. And I was just like, well, but I love Periscope. That's, I just took it for granted. I always assumed, I think one of the reasons why I kind of like just relegated it to streaming myself playing piano is I assumed that something like this would come along, something else, because there's really something unique here. but it is difficult to find a brand model or a revenue model for it. So, I keep thinking, trying to think about who would buy this car. Because this, the Jeep does still, there is some truth in that Jeep being unique thing, because people that don't care what they drive don't buy Jeeps. There has to be a, there's either like a family thing, or your friend, or your partner. Whether or not, you know, your perception of Jeep, like mine, maybe, is founded in truth or not, who really knows? I mean, you can't, Jeep as a brand, what does that even mean? I guess that's what I've been trying to get at, like, at this point. I'm pretty sure this steering wheel is the same one that's in the Fiat 500. What does Jeep even mean? I'm driving a Jeep that has a heated steering wheel and adjustable heated leather seats. What does Jeep mean, really, at that point? I think a lot of us, having reckoned with myself, or this within myself recently, want to, especially the guys who continue to drive trucks even after they get, like, insurance jobs, they want, you buy a truck for a purely emotional reason. It's because you want to project something about yourself. And it's not even about being big or whatever. It's about carrying something with you wherever you want to go. You know, you might not use your truck to work with your hands. You know, you might have an insurance job, but you still value the things that a truck represents to you. But at this point, I think we really need to start, we have to ask the question, like, what do products like this represent to us? Because, frankly, the signals I'm getting, I like to think I'm good at summing up cars, especially in a few words. I'm just getting more, the signals are more and more mixed. I mean, driving that Mustang was like, man, I mean, it was... I mean, I think if you are going to buy a Mustang, you should get the EcoBoost, because that's, like... Hello. Wow. What's happening? There we go. I have to drop the puppy off at home. He doesn't like it. He doesn't like it at all. It's actually kind of misleading, which is a good thing to say, but one of the I feel like is lacking out of many in automotive criticism right now. It's talking to customers, talking to people who actually own cars. And granted, people, especially men, hold on to some really dumb opinions about cars. And, I mean, me too. For sure. I have some pretty ignorant assumptions about certain cars that, you know, I'm sure you could empirically prove to be false. But I really like to meet someone who owns a Compass. Because you have, in theory, this car competes with the Subaru Crosstrek and what's the other one? I mean, we should have seen this coming. Compact sport utility vehicle. But not that sport utility vehicle means the same thing it did. I don't know. Americans are just really dumb. Okay? Car buyers are really dumb. Sorry. But it's just, I only, you know, I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings, but like, if, and it's not that it's not the manufacturer's fault, partially, but if crossovers had never happened, I don't know. And that's, like, what I'm trying to say is if consumers were a little bit more reasonable, and by that I mean, okay, so a good example, even though it is kind of a loaded one for people, is the Prius. If we can accept that people buy Priuses because they want to reduce their carbon footprint, well, that is kind of just like an empirically ridiculous idea, because cumulatively, the Prius is like fucking huge nowadays. And you know, you can spec them out with sound dampening and leather, just like any other car. And folks, you can either be efficient. Oh wait, what is it? You can either be efficient or safe or comfortable. I would say that you could be safe and comfortable, but not efficient. I don't know. But that's a, like, you just can't. And it's not that I think there's anything wrong. I don't want to buy a car for, to reduce my carbon footprint. I mean, fuck, I helped, plant thousands of acres of soybeans and wheat when I was a kid. I've already done my part. I've already fed a few thousand people. But, are cool? I was just talking about how Americans are dumb. Especially when it comes to buying cars. But why do you think that? I'm curious. I wish I could give you a better view. But I also can't. I don't know if it'll even occur to me to buy a real from Morocco. I bet you, you're immediately more interesting than anyone in this town, that's for sure. If you say the word Morocco, it doesn't matter, yeah, that's, okay, that's true, that's, America's a lot of things. I think that that's, all of us have trouble understanding just how many things America is. Because our original... Oh, I'm not very interesting. But generally, I know what I'm talking about when it comes to cars. Nothing else, though. Especially not... vaping or geography. For to be honest, I can't even think of, like, very vague image of what Morocco means. And most of it's probably from old advertising. So, but I would say this Jeep Compass is a good example. I mean, it is a great example of how confused we are about our past, what America means, what it means to be proud of it, what it means at all. Yeah, it is a pretty good example of that. I know that's pretentious, but that's my thing. I have the capability of being pretty pretentious about cars. But heading home to drop off the dog. I guess I should, I think I'll drive around a little bit more. I haven't done this in a while. That is, talk about cars. Yeah, Periscope's great. I used to do a car show. And a cat. Yeah, that's a lot more interesting than anything I could ever offer, except maybe my puppy, but he's all the way in the back. And he's infinitely depressed by this car. He does not like it in here. I bet you, and I've never driven anything else in the segment, how much does a new Compass cost? This one, as spec'd, this is a limited, costs $33,094. But it's it's the limited, and it's got four-wheel drive, and it's got leather seats, and a heated steering wheel, and an infotainment system, and auto start, remote start, all that stuff. I think it's pretty straight with the limited package, limited group. It's not, there are no extras ticked on it. But you can spend as little as, I forget what the base is, for a front wheel drive, and it's the same engine there. There's just one engine to choose from. One pitiful engine and transmission combination. I would look that up, but let me see if I wrote that down. No, I didn't write down the base price. Sorry about that. And unfortunately, Googling anything about cars these days has gotten really messy. The resources that I would go to, like AutoWeek and even Autoblog, are like buried deep. This has gotten dirty. I haven't cleaned anything. I haven't cleaned the outside, I haven't cleaned the inside. Again, I apologize. 2011. Okay, I was just talking about how I was really interested in talking to people that had owned a Compass. So if you've got the time, please stick around and tell me what you think. I mean, if you're looking to get another one, if you're at all interested, I'm assuming that you like your Compass. And I'm especially interested to know why you're interested in the Compass over, like, there's the Crosstrek and then there's one other car in the segment. as it's defined. I haven't driven the CrossTrek yet, but people, MotorTrend at least seems to think they're in the same segment. All right, we're actually descending kind of a hill here. Fortunately, since the last time I did a car review, I've become kind of an antsy driver because I've gotten 2 car accidents. Nine gears, folks. Which one do I choose? That one? It's almost like it's a toy. 92,000 with no issues. Well, that's a good vouch. I wonder how much that is. I just don't... Oh, I'm sorry. I wish I knew more about this model. I don't know the history of its development. Well, I've officially gotten lost. Totally without, like, without reason. Oh, there it is. That makes sense. If anything, they should put something rougher in here. You need more space. Are you going for the Cherokee? It's not much more space. I'm assuming you want an SUV. Does Jeep make a full-size SUV? Or is the Cherokee how's the sound system? That's a good question. Actually, it's pretty good. But let's not that you can hear anything from the 96 kilobit per second at best MP3 audio stream you're listening to right now. But let's can't torture the dog too much, but I am 200 yards away from my house. Media, no media device available. Radio. Let's listen to the ball game, folks.
This 382-968. There were 2 or 3.
Yes, sir.
I guarantee it.
Select styles.
No music on the radio, apparently.
Actually, this.
I don't even think this radio station's in stereo, to be honest. Okay. Okay, instead of, because you're here, former Compass owner, I'm gonna keep scoping while I get the puppy inside. Here is what I've been looking at. The trim is not too bad. I'll spend $33,100 on it though. That's a little much.
Hello, Puppo. How are you? Do you like the compass? He doesn't like the compass at all. Well, really? That's a revelation. Oh, puppy! Oh, a baby to pee. I will. Give me just a sec. I have to get this poor bear. Come on, buddy. Sorry. Very professional. Bear, come on. Good boy. Go potty. The worst possible conditions. I actually show you this guy.
Something smells like it's burning. That's interesting. To be honest with ya, this really bores me. But, you know, anything, I guess it's more interesting than it. I mean, this view. It's more interesting than, like, the fucking cross track. Compass is such a dumb name. If you're gonna name it Compass, at least do something completely, like, have a huge, gyro-stabilized compass or something, like, in the dash. It is well-proportioned. It's pleasing. It certainly could be worse-looking, that's for sure. And it's dirty right now. I have not cleaned it since I got it old. So, Doggo does not like it so much back here, but, you know, I have not been driven in the back seat yet. Well, this isn't exactly a fair representation of it. Horrendous, to be honest. The numbers kind of sound like a 9-speed ZF automatic paired with a 2.4 liter 180 horsepower for, like I said, you know, sounds like the transmission would really be able to put the engine where it needs to be to get the right amount of torque, but that face. The power is never there when you need it. And I think the drivetrain really lets this down more than anything. And again, I'm really tired of saying that about FCA products. No, it's not a CVT. It's a traditional automatic with a torque converter. But it's 9 speeds, 9 gears. It's made by the transmission people, ZF, the German people, German transmission guys. The ones that make transmissions for Jaguar and you know, I drove, it depends on the application. A CVT would be almost a hilarious inclusion in this particular car, but on the Nissan Juke Nismo, that CVT is like ridiculously well sorted. It's got fake gears, right? But it shifts very quickly. It shifts faster than this does when you put it into sport mode. Of course, you can't tow anything with a CVT, right? And this is something in theory that you'd want to maybe tow something every once in a while. It smells like, oh, yeah, I can imagine. That's a shame. Because the CVT on the Versa, from what I've heard, I know a few people, okay, so I think I know one person who has a new Versa, and he Uber drives, and his has got a CVT, and he loves it. He hasn't let me drive his car yet, but he says that it's like, but he just doesn't notice, and that's what the Versa is for, right? I'm misstepping a lot recently, as is Honda. But they've had their time, haven't they? Well, I was thinking, I might eat and go drive a little bit more. We should really take it on gravel, shouldn't we? You know what? Let's just go do that. Let me refill my fluids here. Thanks for sticking with me.